surprise, NASA needs more money to get back to the moon by 2024, warns the White House in a letter to Congress. Well, corruption isn't cheap, folks. And on that topic, we thought it would be fun to do a comparison between SLS and Starship, especially in light of the future costs and launch capabilities. Hint, one is vastly superior. Then last week, we talked about the Lunar Gateway, where we tried to see it more positively. Here, we want to clarify our thoughts on that topic, because many people have misunderstood us and thought that we would defend the Lunar Gateway, which, as you know, is absolutely not the case. We, of course, still think the Gateway is a
crackpot idea. That's what I think. How about that? How about a little of that? I think it's a crackpot idea.
But there are at least some positive developments we want to talk about, namely NASA has just 2 days ago announced the selection of SpaceX to join its commercial lunar payload services program, you know, with this cute little lunar lander here.
And of course, we also want to take a look over at our Chinese friends, what they are doing, because I, for one, have always been a very good friend of China. I hope they will remember this when they invade Germany. So stay tuned for these highly interesting developments.
So here we are with the Artemis, or maybe we should call it the Artemis program. In Monday's episode, which you can watch right here, we talked about the insane corruption that is going on with how NASA is awarding contracts to the likes of Boeing and Lockheed, and thus how much money is being wasted.
Also, time and time again on this channel, we wanted to show how insanely inefficient and what a waste of budget the SLS, Orion, and Gateway Moon mission architecture is. And the funny thing is, even though it might sometimes sound exaggerated what we say, our views are confirmed time and time again.
So after the Senate Appropriations Committee released its fiscal year 2020 budget bill in September, Russell Wout, the acting director of the White House Office of Management and Budget, responded with a letter to share some additional views on the process. The letter from the 23rd of October provides some highly interesting insights into NASA's space launch system. In this letter, Russell Wout wrote to the chairman of the Senate Appropriations Committee, Alabama Republican Richard Shelby, that it would be much cheaper to launch the Europa Clipper mission on a commercial rocket. Turns out, the SLS costs $1.5 to $2 billion per launch.
You heard that right, $1.5 to $2 billion. Billion, like with a B, not M. I wish it was an M, but no, it's a B, like billion. However, our good friend Richard Shelby doesn't want to save money because, as you know, a large part of the SLS rocket is being assembled at the Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama. And of course, if suddenly missions like the Europa Clipper, which, by the way, will search for signs of life in the subsurface oceans of the fascinating Jupiter moon Europa, a highly fascinating mission, would suddenly be launched much cheaper, then SLS would be completely obsolete. And that, of course, would mean a lot of jobs lost in Alabama.
Sweet home Alabama, where Senator Shelby reigns supreme.
What was that? And our good Senator Shelby, of course, doesn't like that. He doesn't like losing the jobs in Huntsville, Alabama. So the Europa Clipper is currently slated to launch in 2023 or 2024. But the problem is, this is at a time when Boeing is capable of producing one SLS per year. Like one per year. One per year. Compare that to Starship launching 3 times per day. But more on that later.
During that same time period, however, the SLSs will be needed for Artemis, because the same corrupt politicians like Shelby, of course, want Artemis 3, which is planned to land on the moon in 2024, also to be launched by the SLS. So you see the big problem here. There simply won't be enough SLSs. Now, in order to make it to the moon by 2024 in an Orion capsule launched by the SLS, Russell Wild requested an additional $2.3 billion for the fiscal year 2020 budget in order to keep NASA on track for their Artemis 3 mission. This is up from the current $22.8 billion budget for the fiscal year 2019, which had already been raised by $1.6 billion.
Of course, in an ideal world not ruled by corrupt politicians, which unfortunately is not our world, of course they would scrap SLS altogether and go full Starship. You know what? Let's just do a fun comparison between SLS and Starship, just for the fun of it. So SLS will cost 1.5 to 2 billion per launch, will not be reusable, that is 100% non-reusable, will have in the Block 1 configuration a payload capacity of about 95 metric tons to LEO, a bit more than 26 tons to the Moon, and as we found out, can fly an impressive one time per year. One! At least until Boeing can produce more SLS Block 1s, which will not be before the mid-2020s, realistically. And how does Starship compare to that? Well, it will cost 2 million per launch. Million! Like M! As Elon recently revealed, we'll have a LEO capacity of more than 100 tons, probably around 100 tons to low Earth orbit, plus minus, a payload of 100 tons to the Moon thanks to orbital refueling, even 100 tons to Mars with orbital refueling, and can fly 3 times per day. Per day! Not per year, per day! So, SLS, 2 billion per launch, can fly once per year. Starship, 2 million per launch, can fly 3 times per day. So 1,000 times per year. So Starship will be 1 million times, 1,000 times 1,000, more efficient than the SLS. That's how insane the difference between Starship and SLS is. It really is a factor of 1 freaking million. This was a fun comparison, but it's just insane when we remind ourselves again how much more efficient Starship actually is compared to the Senate launch system, or should I say, the Shelby launch system.
And because we are so nicely in rant mode again, let's talk about the Lunar Gateway. Dear viewers, of course we haven't become fans of the Gateway. Far from it. Freshly coming back from America, suddenly everything seemed so nice. So maybe we were a bit too soft on that day when we recorded this episode here. But now, being back in the brutal, dark, gray and foggy realm of Germania, the hate is being reawakened and now burns again like a radiant flame within our chest. What we wanted to say last time was that we fully understand how inefficient the Lunar Gateway is for landing on the Moon again. And Starship would be the perfect solution to get humans back to the Moon and also to build a moon base from the beginning. However, we live in this corrupt world with people like Shelby and companies like Boeing. So NASA is being a pawn of some corrupt politicians and of US Congress. In that light, and only taking that into account, the Lunar Gateway is better than nothing. Because we would probably see the next try of directly building a lunar base getting cancelled again by the next administration. So only in light of politics, the Gateway might not be so bad. Because at least that way, NASA will fly beyond low Earth orbit again, which is much better than being stuck in low Earth orbit again for another 10 years. Of course, fortunately, this time we have SpaceX and Starship. So probably it doesn't matter in the end what will happen with the Gateway. But yeah, we certainly haven't become fans of the Gateway idea. But at least we start seeing NASA more and more opening up to Starship for landing on the Moon, something which we wanted to see since we started this channel here. In fact, we already foresaw in this video here from half a year ago that the only real option NASA would have for returning to the Moon by 2024 would be to utilize Starship. Back then, they had not even acknowledged the existence of Starship. So 2 days ago, NASA announced in an official press release that they chose Blue Origin, Ceres Robotics,
Sierra Nevada Corporation, Tevec Nano Satellite Systems Inc., and lastly SpaceX for their commercial lunar payload services initiative. Even though we find it a bit strange that the most impressive of those lunar landers is the last one, you really have to scroll down to the bottom of the page to find the Starship render, which is quite funny, you know, because Starship is actually not really a moon lander, but a multi-purpose interplanetary transport system, so really vastly superior to these other tiny lunar landers. So putting Starship last is really ridiculous, when the reality feels more like this.
In any case, this is probably still better than not mentioning Starship at all, we guess. Starship is, by the way, so much more capable that it can bring 100 tons of payload to the moon compared to the other landers that can only land very small payloads of the order of a few hundred kilograms. In this official NASA Starship render, we actually see storage space for at least two very big pressurized rovers, possibly even three or four of them, plus probably storage space for quite a few Bigelow habitat modules. Now that is what we call a proper payload.
And what are the Chinese doing? Well, it turns out they are already busy testing their lander for their upcoming 2020 Mars mission. Now, as we know, the Chinese have really a pretty good track record with their space missions. Not only the crewed Shenzhou missions, but also the uncrewed ones such as their Chang'e moon missions, which all have been a complete success. The Chinese U22 rover is, by the way, still roaming on the far side of the moon and making scientific discoveries as we speak. So as we can see here, they were testing the lander on tethers to simulate a Mars gravity descent onto the surface. The test took place on the 14th of November, and by the way, this mission will not only consist of a lander, but of course also of an orbiter that will relay back all the data from the surface mission back to Earth and vice versa, and a rover also. That is quite amazing. So they will have a moon rover in action now and a Mars rover. And since their past track record is very good, we think the chances of mission success are quite high, even though, of course, landing on Mars is more difficult because of the nasty atmosphere that is too thin for good aerobraking, but too thick as to land easily like on the moon. So that's actually also the reason why the Soviets never really managed to land on Mars. In any case, we of course hope they will make it, because the more rovers and landers we have on Mars, the better.
So what do you think about this whole affair with the SLS costing up to $2 billion per launch? It's insane, right?
It's crazy. And do you, especially you dear American viewers, have an idea how to stop this madness? I mean, we have an idea like in 300 with Sparta. No, this might work. The Spartan solution sometimes works, but then again, everyone says, you're too violent, this is not good, you're too violent.
And what do you think about the Chinese Mars mission? Will they be successful in 2020?
I think they will be certainly successful, because China is amazing, and I like China very much, and I'm a very good friend of China. Always have been a very good friend of China.
Very good, Sebastian.
So be sure to subscribe and turn on that notification bell, because we regularly upload twice per week, mostly on space topics, but also EV and other technologies. So, see you next time!
Sweet home Alabama, where you chase the SLS pipe dream, reign supreme.
Gott, nicht schlecht.
Ah!